What's the personality profile of a person that gets really into conspiracy theories? Because in my experience, it's never seemed to me to be a problem of intelligence. I've met some of the most intelligent people, you know, people that scare me with how smart they are. Where I'm clearly, you just know very quickly you're in the presence of someone just like cognitively sharper than you, but that are all in on some of the craziest conspiracy theories, right? And I do think famously there is a guy with maybe the highest IQ in the world that was a total far right white supremacist. And the kind of a white supremacist that was deeply into particular conspiracy theories, right? And it seems to me that the part of the mind that is, you know, is tasked with noticing patterns in the world, you know, you can ratchet that up to 11, but if you're noticing the wrong patterns or you have some, for whatever reason, inclination towards it, you can use all of that cognitive power to just make more and more compelling nonsense. So I wonder if you've noticed what type of person becomes into conspiracy theories.
Yeah, I like to say that belief and intelligence are orthogonal. They're like this. They're not related to each other. Except after the fact, once you've committed to a belief, intelligent, educated people are better at rationalizing beliefs that they arrived at for non-intelligent, rational reasons. So they're better at looking stuff up and finding, connecting the dots and surfing the net and making all those arguments you've heard, you know, like a nanothermite and super secret, super nanothermite and the speed at which buildings fall. I mean, when I started investigating the 9/11 truthers, I couldn't believe how complicated a lot of this stuff was, you know, architects and engineers for 9/11 truth. Like you read their papers, like, okay, these are not dummies.
Yeah.
Clearly they're smart and they have tons of facts. Obviously, that's not enough. So the psychology of conspiracy theorists, conspiracists, they're not, you know, overweight 40-year-olds living in their mother's basement. That's a myth with a tinfoil hat. You know, these are normal people. Most of us believe in some conspiracy or another, which may be true, maybe not. So just normal people. Different cohorts have different emphasis on conspiracy theories. You know, white, you'd say African Americans tend to believe, you know, because of the Tuskegee mess and all that and other things that really happened that were really bad, they tend to think, say, for example, during the crack cocaine epidemic, that was orchestrated by the CIA or the FBI, I forget which one. Now we're seeing with the vaccine shy people in some African American communities because of Tuskegee and so on. But whites, you know, okay, it's guns. They're going to take away our guns, or they're building, you know, Obama's building concentration camps in Texas to put us poor white people with guns away, and on and on. So different groups have different conspiracies that they believe in, having to do with power, mostly power. Who has it? Who doesn't? Who thinks somebody else has power and who wants to get it? Again, the weird reversal with Trump is that almost every losing campaign in history has thought the election was rigged somehow. There was some shenanigans or something. The winners, who were also worried about this, the moment they won, they just drop it. Like, oh, no, that was a totally fair election. The weird thing about Trump is he keeps talking about it was a rigged election. It's like, dude, you won. Shut up. you're not supposed to be talking. Anyway, so quirky.
Yeah.
There are differences in, say, just kind of open to new ideas, maybe too open to ideas that could be sort of a gullibility rather than a skeptical element to them. There was an interesting study done called Dead and Alive, and it had to do with people that ticked the box for saying that Princess Diana was killed were also more likely to tick the box that she faked her death and is still alive somewhere. Well, they can't both be true. She can't be dead and alive. And but the consistent finding in that study was that people that are distrustful of authorities or official stories tend to do this across the board. No matter what story you give them, they go, yeah, I doubt that. I don't think we're getting the full story on that. My colleagues at Chapman University did a funny story about that very phrasing. To what extent do you think the government has not been forthright in giving us the full explanation for, you know, Pearl Harbor, 9/11, blah, blah, blah. And then they threw one in, the North Dakota crash. Well, 33% of Americans said they had some doubt that the government was telling us the full story about the North Dakota crash. What North Dakota crash? They just made that up. They just threw it in there just to see if people would tick the box. So either people don't know what they're doing when they take surveys, or they're just are kind of globally skeptical of any kind of authority.
Right. And I share that skepticism in many ways, but, and this is another thing I've noticed, is that I've often found I tend to get along with conspiracy theorists up until they start talking about their favorite conspiracy, at which point I'm totally skeptical. But it does seem to me, you know, my position as a writer has often been that I'm challenging what I view as a mainstream consensus on the topic of race. So, yeah, for instance, the idea that, you know, I remember when Ahmaud Arbery was killed several months ago, you see a New York Times op-ed about how it's rational for Black people to fear for their lives when they go out on a jog. And that's something I'm seeing in the New York Times, which is, you know, obviously enormously respected, mainstream, so forth. And immediately, I just doubt this, right? I doubt it from the point of view of common sense, from the point of view of, as well as from the point of view of just being in touch with the data, in addition to lived experience. The whole set of ways in which people come to conclusions about the world, I very much doubt it makes sense for a Black person to fear for their life going for a jog. And yet, I'm sort of constantly inundated by this sort of species of beliefs that seem totally irrational to me. And that has definitely led to a skepticism, especially with regard to certain issues about which I know that a place like the New York Times is going to reliably exaggerate. And so I can often get along with a conspiracy theorist because they can sense that I also doubt what the man is telling us, or whatever. But then it just, you know, the moment you start talking about a specific conspiracy, I can't get on board with almost anyone, because I'm thinking of how many people would have had to keep it silent. You know, that's a huge factor for me in the implausibility of, you know, 99% of conspiracy theories. If it requires two or three people to keep a secret, then I'm listening. If it requires hundreds, right, then everything I know about human nature and the tendency to gossip and how difficult it is to even keep a secret from your friend's friend, right? Just reflect on your own social life. Like, how long have you been able to keep a secret, or how many secrets have been told to you by your friend? Did you know X did Y with, you know, it takes about 2 seconds. It's like, we love gossip more than we almost love food, right? So
that's right.
Especially when something as juicy as a huge conspiracy theory, right? That you just can't keep that.
Yeah. How many times have you said to a friend, okay, I'm going to tell you this one thing, but you can't tell anybody else.
Exactly.
And then they do the exact same thing. Yeah, three people can keep a secret if two of them are dead. Ben Franklin. Right. Yeah, I was on G. Gordon Liddy's radio show in the 90s. My first book came out, Why People Believe Weird Things. And of course, he was one of the main orchestrators of Watergate, the Watergate break-in. Mm. And he asked me that question. I said, well, you're the one who knows about this. And he goes, yeah. The two things he said were the can't keep their mouth shut problem and the competency problem. Most bureaucrats are incompetent. You know, if you have a dozen of them have to do 20 different things all at the right time, they're not going to do it. I mean, Watergate break-in is a classic example. All they had to do is break into a hotel room, excuse me, and steal some stuff. They couldn't even do that. But, you know, so much less, you know, orchestrate world domination for the United States. You know, impossible. You just can't get that many people to do those things.